You know, it's a strange coincidence that the speakers we have today, it wasn't intended, but it's wonderful because there's some really, you know, a kind of overlapping thread to both speakers, which is that they don't just, they're not just part of very important cultural and political conversations, but their lives, in a sense, embody that conversation. They literally have lived out history with their lives. The second speaker of the evening, Atish, of course, is a writer, and after the cocktail break, we'll be having him. But first up is General Shah, who was the deputy chief of the Indian Army, who fought in the 1971 war, who's fought you know, in all the insurgencies in the Northeast. He was part of quelling the Punjab insurgency. He quelled the riots in Gujarat 2002. And you know, he has really played, he's been in all the battlefronts of India. And at that peak of his career, he of course lived out his tenure as the deputy chief, but then went on to become the vice chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University and fought many other battles there, all of which are extremely germane to our cultural conversation. Today, in writing of his tenure in the army, which again, not to, you know, to foreground his identity as a Muslim, but it's important to remember that even in the Indian army, the percentage of Muslims in the army is barely 2.5%, if I have that correctly. So General Shah, by being a Muslim who reached pretty much the top of the army you know, rungs, has lived out a very, very important role in our cultural conversation. In writing of that tenure and in writing of his battles in the university, it's intriguing that he's called his book Sarkari Musalman. What does that term really mean, and what are its implications for us all? So to listen to both stories of glory and of battle and of what it really is to live in a conflict zone and in a war zone, and also to understand that that business of being the cultural conversation itself. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming General Shah. Thank you very much for being here, sir.
My pleasure.
Your book is really a roller coaster ride, as I said, through literally all the battlefields that India has had to, you know, has found itself enmeshed in. So that's fascinating, and I'm going to come to that. But before we start on the anecdotes, the insights, that title was really, really intriguing. So will you share with the audience what it means to be a Sarkari Musalman, why you chose that title, and what is the irony of having been one?
Well, Sarkari Musalman is a sobriquet or a name given to generally a Muslim government servant who doesn't pander to the requests, sometimes unfair, of his own community. So when you don't pander to some requests, bekar hai inke paas jana, Sarkari Musalman hai ye. So a government servant really has to walk a tightrope between loyalty to his job and loyalty to his community. You have to really walk a tightrope, and you have to balance out the two. Now, there's another variety of Sarkari Muslims who are derided because, having been born Muslims, they deride their own religion into which they were born and draw benefit from doing it. They pander to Islamophobia. I've named, of course, Salman Rushdie. He was born a Muslim, but his totally unreadable book, The Satanic Verses, it is unreadable, and I read it because it was banned. And that was the biggest mistake the Ayatollah did, banning the book. Because I read through the whole thing, but he made millions out of it, because the people lapped it up. The second, of course, closer to home is Taslima Nasreen. I admire her for the work she's doing in gender politics and other things. But what I don't like is her Islam bashing. I saw a photograph of hers during Ramadan. She says, enjoying lunch, happy Ramadan. Now that would endanger or would anger conservative or any Muslim, I mean, who's being made fun of, happy Ramadan, enjoying lunch. So this is what really affected me was when I was a young young lieutenant. I met, I was in Mussoorie, and I met these 10 or 12 real strapping horsemen. So I inquired who they were, and I was told they were the Aligarh Muslim University riding team, which had come to participate in AMU, in the IMA, horse show. So I said, here's a captive audience, and I tried to tell them the honor of glory of wearing uniform. And I said, the army is looking for polo players, why don't you join? And I said, this is the best profession you can get. At the end of my lecture, I asked, how many of you want to join? Not a single hand was raised, but they did say, Saab, aap to sarkari musalman hai. That means what you are doing, you are pushing a government agenda. So since that very time, I felt that this was a title, if I ever wrote a book, I would call it the Sarkari Musalman.
So if you don't look through at yourself through the perspective of others, what is the Muslim you see yourself to be? You know, in that tightrope between the Taslima Nasreens and Rushdis and the stooge that, you know, some in your community might think you are, where do you actually position yourself in that conversation?
Well, I drew strength from my faith, as anybody would. I've got a lot of friends, relatives who are agnostic. They are not practicing Muslims. They have also a faith and belief in something. I think it is an anchor one can hold on to. And my faith has been an anchor for me. And nobody minded it. My troops, I served in an environment where I was the sole Muslim in my regiment. They were all Rajputs. But I participated in everything, which, for example, in the army, a commanding officer is expected to go to the mandir. So it's called a mandir parade. Irrespective of religion, you do attend the mandir parade. It is not a form of worship. It is a parade which you are doing. So I think that my belief in my religion and belief in my country don't run counter to each other. In fact, they strengthen each other. So that's the way I viewed it. So Islam says you have to honor the country in which you serve and into which you were born. And that's the way I looked at it.
So I'm going to come back to this conversation a little later because, you know, you started out in a madrasa and that's another kind of bugbear in most people's minds. We'll come back to that. But first, a little bit about the army. And, you know, it's interesting that you come from a family with almost 200 years of some kind of service or association with armies. I won't say the army. You know, sometimes on the side of the British, sometimes on the side of the nationalists. You have a great-grandfather who almost got blown to smithereens by cannons in Afghanistan.
That was my father.
Was it your father?
I thought
it was your great-grandfather. Okay, so that close, you know. So your brother Nasiruddin Shah had to run away to be an actor. Was this a family calling that you just went to? Or, you know, having served so long, was your family resistant to you joining the army? How did that desire to join the army come into you?
Well, since my family had been soldiering for hundreds of years, and my grandfather was an old cavalryman, having fought in the First World War in the trenches. He was from 37 Lancers Baluch. But they shed their horses and fought in the trenches for 4 years. And when he came back, I've got a photograph of that in the book. So I wanted to follow the family tradition, and my father gave me support. He had escaped to Afghanistan with his uncle to try and reclaim the family estates, which we lost in 1843 after the First Afghan War, where my great-great-grandfather was sentenced to death and had to flee from Afghanistan and came to India and was given a jagir in Sardana, that's near Meerut. So in the mutiny, or whatever you call it, War of Independence, we fought with the British. And my children could not accept that. They felt it was disloyalty to the nation. And I took pains to explain that in 1857, there was no nation. Everybody fought. It was all tribal warfare. Everybody fought for his own tribe and which would benefit the tribe. My tribe felt that being with the winning side and being with the side which gave us shelter after we fled from Afghanistan. So we established the bridgehead over the Hindon, my family, which enabled the Brits to cross. So I said there was nothing disloyal about it. There was no loyalties to a nation. It was loyalty to your tribe. So this was a calling, and I felt that the army would serve whatever I was looking for, honor, glory, a life of outdoors. I was, from childhood, since I was living with my grandfather, we were shikaris. He was fond of guns, horses, and firearms. So I imbibed all that, and I thought the army would be a calling, and it answered it.
So, just a little bit more on the family before we move away to the, your actual tenure in the army. You and your father then came from this sort of strand of disciplined behavior of being part of the, of serving forces. And then you had a brother like Nasiruddin Shah, who is the most recalcitrant sort of family member that it's possible to have. All his dreams were in opposition to what the family stood for. And he ran away when he was a young boy. He had a very strange relationship with your father, which he often speaks of now with sorrow, because they could not even reconcile before your father passed away. How do you see that, when you look back to your own upbringing and to Nasir's? What played out well for you and what went wrong for Nasir?
Well, I've written a chapter on my brother called Living Under the Shadow of a Celebrity Brother. So
I'm sorry I asked you that question so early in our interview.
So in jest, I've given a lot of questions which I'm asked. The favorite question is he your real brother? So I said, is there anything like an artificial brother? But my father felt that acting was not an honorable line for a Shah. And he tried to convince him that, look at your elder brother. My elder brother, of course, was the brains, and he went off to IIT Kharagpur. I joined the NDA after my education in St. Joseph's, Nainital. And Nasir was dreadful in studies. So he had to leave school because he failed in class 9. But despite all that, he still made good. And that is because of the strength of the schooling we got. And I'll come to that later, that the foundation has to be good. And also, irrespective of where you are, who you are, what color, religion, caste, creed, if you have a good, solid school foundation, you can succeed in life. That is my belief. So we tried to convince Nasir to join the armed forces. For 2 or 3 days after my passing out parade, he was very impressed. He said, I think I'll give it a try. But then he ran away. But he still made good. So it is on the strength of education.
So clearly you haven't spoken to Nasir for a long time about this, because Nasir sat on this very stage and said that school is perhaps the most nightmarish memory of his entire life. And you're clearly making false claims for your brother, because schooling is not what did it for him.
No. See, what happened was, Nasir always had that intense desire to become an actor. My elder brother, who was brilliant, was always given the lead roles, won Best Actor awards many times. But for the weak students, they were not allowed to participate in dramatics. They had to go for extra classes, which he was forced to do, and he hated it. He hated school because he was not allowed to act, but had to attend extra classes in maths and everything else. So that's why he hated school, but I loved school. I was not a brilliant student. In fact, I was a second divisioner. And fortunately for me, the day my results came from Senior Cambridge, my dad opened two envelopes. First one was Senior Cambridge results. Oh, he says, you got a second div? Not a good result at all. I hung my head down. Second envelope was the call letter from NDA. So that was saving grace. And that's how it went.
So I remember, Nasir, when you're talking about how they tortured him, that he said that he hated the Christian brothers under whom you all studied, because the peculiar torture they devised was that he who loved movies was made to sit with his back to the screen when they would show films.
Absolutely. I mean, that was torture of the highest order. Anybody who was to be punished had to sit in the cinema hall, but with his back towards the screen. I mean, it was Chinese torture, absolutely.
So now let's come to the battle lines. You know, as you said, you've fought in pretty much every single battlefront that India has had. And 1971 is the really big one, you know, which transformed India's sense of itself. So give us a sense of the battle at Longewala and you know, what you yourself did. And then you have a very interesting codicil to that, because again, Sam Manekshaw is such a national icon. But typical of you, with your kind of restraint, you've been dangling carrots, which you're not quite chewing on in the book. I hope you'll chew on it a little more. So I'll come to that. But first, what was your experience at the Battle of Longewala?
Well, the first thing is that we knew that we were going into liberation of Bangladesh. And we had mobilized in August 71. I was from a camel regiment. And just before the war, we shed the camels and had got motorized transport, and thank God for that, because it used to take me 7 days of hard riding from Bikaner up to Thanot, our operational area. So talking of, battle ready, readiness, I'm afraid it was not there. But we were addressed by Sam Manekshaw in the last week of November. He had all the officers of the division were sitting on a sand dune, and there was a table covered with a service blanket and a chair and a microphone. And we heard Sam Manekshaw's chopper landing. He came in, brushed aside the chair, stood on the table. He didn't need any microphone, and he just told us two or three things. He says, "Boys, I'm sending you across." His first sentence. "I'm telling you three things. First is, prisoners of war will not be ill-treated. Secondly," you know, it made a lot of sense. "Second," he says, "there'll be no booty taking. And third," he says, "keep away from the Pakistani begums." That's all he said. His speech lasted about 2 or 3 minutes because he was in a tearing hurry. He had to address. But we knew that we had to go in. He said, "ensure victory. You are going in." So we knew that there was a lot of talk whether we are going to go to war or not. But the signal had been given. He jumped off the table, had a cup of tea with us, and disappeared and went off. But what he had was charisma. He really affected us. It was invigorating to hear him talk, to see him. What a great personality. He had charisma, which cannot be faked. It was inborn in him. So we were ready to go in on 4th of December. We were at Thanot, and we were ready to go in with the objective being Rahim Yar Khan. This was the communication center of Pakistani Sindh. But the Pakistanis surprised us. That night when we were moved in into Pakistan and captured Islamgarh, my battery was involved in battering the fortress. They attacked on our east. That means they wanted to outflank us and came in into Longewala, where my battery, another battery was deployed. It was a light regiment, so we were deployed in penny packets, not as one regiment. So we were swerved from heading north. We had to come back and go west towards the north. We were sitting ducks for the Pakistani Air Force, but anyway, we got through. And I reached Longewala on 4th night. The battle was on. The guns of one of the batteries was deployed. We built up the whole regiment. The Pakistanis made one blunder. They had surrounded the post. We could see the tanks all round, letting loose on the post. We were firing at them with the artillery. We had a regiment of antiquated AMX-13 tanks, which would have been blown to bits by the Pakistani T-59s, Chinese tanks. Anyway, there was a wire fence around the post at Thanot, which seems to have hindered the Pakistani armor from assaulting the post. Also, they were waiting for the infantry to come up, which didn't fetch up. One of the cardinal principles of war is don't separate your armor from the infantry. But the Pakistani 22 cavalry, I think it was T-59 tanks, the whole regiment was around the post, and there was no infantry. Next morning, we called in the hunters, and the whole regiment was destroyed around the post. So that saved our skins, really. The Pakistani infantry then fetched up, and we took a lot of prisoners of war. And then we pushed into Pakistan and went in about 15, 16 kilometers when the ceasefire was declared. But what was surprising was one night, I was in the gun position, three khaki-clad figures came. They were armed. They said, "Don't shoot. We are Bengali officers." They were actually deserters from the Pakistan army who had deserted and come in and come into our gun position. So we welcomed them. Of course, we disarmed them, sent them back. And they fought subsequently with the Mukti Bahini. So the fact of the matter is that Pakistan violated the principles of war, but they took us by surprise by outflanking us at Longewala. If you have seen the movie Border, it's rubbish. I'll tell you why. Because Major Chandpuri, who did a great job at Longewala, so did his CO, Colonel Hussain, who was at Sadewala, his commanding officer. But the movie has shown him in very poor light, which all of us represented. I says, how are you reflecting a CO of a regiment? Because just because he's Hussain, you are showing him in bad light, which I thought was, I didn't like the movie basically because of that. But 71 was a great, great operation. And of course, I did get to know a lot of what happened in Bangladesh from General Jacob. But that you will probably ask me later. But in the West, it was holding. We didn't want to, of course, the aim was Rahim Yar Khan. We didn't achieve that. But we did succeed in preventing a thrust into Jaisalmer.
So, sir, I'm going to come to General Jacobs and, you know, the reference you make to his version of what happened in the war and, you know, his assessment of General Manekshaw and others. But it's very interesting because even there you've talked about the political articulation of how a war is positioned or how a victory is positioned. What was your understanding of the surgical strikes that happened recently? You know, that's not to take away from the bravery of the army at all, but just about it being positioned as a really epochal moment that has never been done before from being someone within the army. Do you think that the political articulation of that was a fair one?
Let me tell you that I was in 1983, we carried out a surgical strike into Myanmar. We did what we had to do and came back. Of course, we had a cover-up plan that if things got very messy, we would give the excuse that we were climbing a Saramathi peak and lost our way and strayed into Myanmar. But I personally feel that these are things which one shouldn't talk about. These strikes, we've been doing that for a very long time. We never talked about it. I think political capital should not be taken from this. This is should be left to the army. I think we are endangering our own forces by talking about these operations. I think they would best be left unsaid.
So, you know, you've mentioned about General Jacob's book. You've mastered, sir. You've of course had a career in diplomacy as well. But to have an army officer who's also a diplomat, who's also an educator, that's quite a combination, you know. So you've talked about General Jacob's book, in which he had a draft where his assessment of General Manekshaw and a couple of others was very scathing, you know. And you asked him to water it down. Today, sir, will you share with us what that draft was? Why you asked him to water it down? And if you want Chatham House rules, we'll observe them. But do share with us why General Jacobs had a different opinion of General Manekshaw.
Well, General Jacob picked me up as a young captain for his military secretary when he was the... of course, he was my GOC was when I was in the Camel Regiment. And I tried to impress him, trying to show that the camels were required. And he told me, okay, select the worst terrain you can find and I'll take my jeep up. So we selected a dhora, a sand dune, where I was sure that General Jacob wouldn't be able to negotiate. He came next morning with his ADC and negotiated it with his balloon tires. And I said, are you convinced now? He says, that's the end of the camel regiment. But anyway, when he was army commander, I went in as his staff captain, military secretary. And subsequently, I was in touch with him right through. He always told me that you got a very Jewish nose. You are a member of the lost tribe. You know, this was the lost tribe which came into Afghanistan and they were lost. So I used to joke, I said, sir, you got an Arab nose. So we used to joke. But I am privy to the private correspondence between General Jacob, who was the chief of staff of Eastern Command, and General Gill, who was the Director General of Military Operations. So I am privy to what actually happened. General Jacob disobeyed orders not to move troops from Sikkim. He brought a brigade and artillery down to Bangladesh. The aim of 1971 was salami slicing of Bangladesh. That means we had no intentions of going up to Dhaka. It was salami slicing. We wanted to slice off portions of Bangladesh, declare it, but that would have been very unsuccessful. Bangladesh wouldn't have been recognized. So General Jacob followed the Israeli technique of blitzkrieg with the blessings of the DGMO, disobeying orders, and he forgot about salami slicing, and they said, we must go in for the nerve center of East Pakistan, the Bangladesh now, and that was Dhaka. And that we succeeded, and that ended the war. But the first was that he says that Sam Manekshaw had almost given in to the demand of the political authority to go into Bangladesh in June 1971. General Jacob convinced them that the passes with China were open, the rivers were in floods, and strongly opposed any such move. What he said, quite rightly, he says, we are subordinate to political masters, but not subservient. That means what the army has to do is listen, but put across its point of view. So when General Sam Manekshaw went into the ops room in sometimes in March, or February or April 71, where Srimati, the Prime Minister, had to take a decision as to when we would go in, General Jacob's note was read out by Field Marshal Sam Manekshaw, and he asked for extra time. I mean, he took his advice, and Srimati Indira Gandhi, of course, conceded to that request. So that joke in the book that what he says is, don't put your nose into my affairs and I won't put my long nose, is all a joke. Which he was a very jovial Sam Manekshaw. So actually, they don't believe that. That was a joke. And nobody could dare to tell such a joke to a prime minister who had such iron grip over the country. She had authority. So anyway, he is also described, so that was one. Secondly was his disobedience of orders, not to move any troops from the Chinese border, but General Jacob knew that the Chinese wouldn't, the passes were closed.
So what did you ask him to water down?
It was personal behavior of General Sam Manekshaw, which I think is better not to reflect on. But some personal qualities of his, which I told him, sir, please cut them out. He is a national icon. So General Jacob did listen to me and slashed them. And I'm glad he did, because Sam Manekshaw was somebody we all revered, we hero worshipped. And it wouldn't have been good. And I also told him that he is not here now to answer to whatever you've written. So it was scrapped.
So, sir, let's come to then the, you know, we'll jump a few and we'll come back to the insurgency in the Northeast if we have time. But 2002 Gujarat riots was such a contentious issue in the country. And one of the biggest allegations there was that the army was, you know, not facilitated on time and that the riots were allowed to happen for a while before it was curtailed. You were the general that was brought in to quell the riots. So first question, that did that your Muslim identity there at all become a stumbling block? Was there any internal conversation or, you know, dilly-dallying about your identity at that time? And secondly, you have been very forthright, both about the quality of the police in Gujarat and the nature of action that did take place from the political administration and Mr. Modi particularly. What made you speak up about that now? And was your Muslim identity an issue in bringing you into Gujarat?
No, my Muslim identity was never, I mean, I never felt any pangs or I didn't feel any qualms about what I had to do. But I was informed by General Padmanabhan, who has a very close relationship with me. I was a staff officer when we were sorting out the Punjab insurgency. And he told me a lot of eyebrows were raised as to why a Muslim general was commanding the force committed to sort out the riots in Gujarat. And his answer was that I'll have no meddling. The commander of the force committed will go, plain and simple. And he says, when it comes to a military deployment, we don't take caste, creed, religion, anything into consideration. The commander, whoever's commanding the force, goes. And let me tell you, if I had not been sent, I would have probably resigned in disgust. But the greatness of the army is that they had full faith and trust in a general. And when some eyebrows were raised, the answer was given was, we have not sent a Muslim general. We have sent the commanding general of the force committed. And that finished all matters. This was on 28th of February 2002. We had moved from Secunderabad, where I was commanding a division of the strike corps, and we were in depth. The holding formation, which was in Gujarat, had been moved to the border. So they couldn't be pulled out. And my division was tasked to quell the riots. That evening on 28th of February, I got a call from the chief directly. Now, I was pretty surprised because there's a chain of command. The chief would probably tell the command would tell the corps, and the corps would tell the division commander. But General Paddy, as I just called him, he says, Zoom, that's my nickname in the army. He says, get your division into Gujarat and quell the riots. I said, sir, it'll take 48 hours move from Jodhpur to Ahmedabad. He says, don't worry, the Air Force is laying on the aircraft. Get moving. So I gave orders to my deputy GOC, and I headed for Jodhpur airfield with my ADC and my communications and my vehicle. It was a Herculean effort. 60 flights that night flew us into Ahmedabad. I was in the first aircraft, and I read up on aid to military authority. I didn't want to go wrong. When we were approaching Ahmedabad, I found the whole city burning. There were fires all over. Anyway, we landed, and I didn't find anybody from the civil administration who were to give us the wherewithal. I was told to move light. I had taken the precaution of taking my vehicle. We were to get vehicles, we were to get mobiles, because our communication don't work in high-rise buildings. We were to get magistrates, and we were to get police escort and maps. We didn't have any maps of Gujarat and Ahmedabad. The brigadier, who's my course mate, met me, and I said, where's the civil administration? He shrugged his shoulders. He says, I'm not aware. They'll give you everything. I said, where's the chief secretary? He said, he's abroad. So I said, who's officiating? Well, he gave me a number. I tried to dial. This was around midnight of 28th of February. So getting no response, I realized that the best thing to do was head to the chief minister's house, which I did. And at 2 a.m. on 1st of March 2002, I landed up at Mr. Modi's residence. And to my pleasant surprise, the Raksha Mantri, Mr. George Fernandez, was there. They were having a late dinner or an early breakfast, whatever it was. So they asked me to join, and I was pretty hungry. I had carried a tourist map. So I told the chief minister that this is our requirement. We had been promised, where is it all? He says, Aiga, everything will come. So on a tourist map, we planted the trouble spots. I headed back to the airfield, and the 60 flights brought in 3,000 troops. We were at the airfield. Next morning, a DG of police landed up. He says, I'm your liaison officer. He was 3 stars. So the troops were confused, who's in charge? A 3-star police chap or a 2-star army general? But they knew within a few minutes who was in charge. So I said, where's everything? He says, okay, we are organizing it. That morning, Mr. George Fernandez also came. And I complained. I says, the wherewithal is not provided. How do we move? He says, okay, we'll do something about it. So he addressed a Sainik Sammelan of the troops. He promised that aid would come next morning. That means on the morning of 2nd of March 2002, the Thelas started rolling in, the magistrates, the police, and the maps we got. So it was a delay of more than 24 hours. And I have said earlier that people ask me, there were political accusations. I didn't want to get into any of that. I called it an administrative failure. It was an administrative failure on the part of the, well, if the chief secretary had been there, probably things may have been different. But at least the officiating chief secretary or the home secretary should have ensured that transport was impressed and provided. It was not. And that's how we got delayed.
So, sir, just to stay with this a little bit longer, that you, when you went in to quell the riots, these are now conversations that have been very, very politically charged, not because of any dramatis personae, but these are really the big conversations of our country and which protect our democracy, which was that the police was very partisan, the police hierarchy was very partisan, and that the police stood aside and let the riots happen. You, as leading the army that finally did help quell the riots, you've said that you saw it with your own eyes, that in many times when the minority community was being attacked by a majority mob, police were firing into their homes rather than at the mobs. You've said that the police hierarchy, you told Mr. George Fernandez that the police hierarchy needs to change. Those changes didn't happen. You've said that there was this crucial loss of time before the army that was waiting at the airfield was not called into the city or into the rest of the state for good 36 hours later. So these actually really confirm what a lot of accusations about the dealing with the riots really was. But there were 3 commissions, sir. Why did you not speak up earlier? This is something that Zafar Sarfeshwala has also said. Why did you wait all these years when it was a very, very important conversation?
See, I had no business to volunteer. I was serving in Nagaland, Manipur. I was commanding a corps. And I didn't even know about these commissions. They should have at least asked me or asked for my report where I penned down everything. What was the truth? What was the delay? Of course, I did not comment anything. There were no political comments. I did lambast the police for their blatant partisan role. And this is not the case in Gujarat only. I am from UP, which is very riot prone. And you've heard of the massacre in 1983. Of the police taking 40 youth on a canal, shooting them and dumping their bodies from Malyana. So this is the attitude of the police right across the country, not only in Gujarat, right across. They've been communalized to a great degree, and they're participating or trying to tell them to quell a riot will not succeed because they are active participants in the riot. When I went around with the troops, the police was just standing there. And as you've mentioned, several places when minority homes were surrounded by mobs yelling blue murder, the police was firing into the windows. So I said, what are you doing? They said, we are keeping the mobs at bay. I said, then fire the other side. And whenever there which had surrounded a minority pocket, the police used to just melt away and disappear and tell me, no, we've been called, the DG has called, and they would disappear and leave the dirty work to the army, which they did. I mean, we had issued orders that any arsonist was to be shot, and we did. We shot up about the first night about 20 people, arsonists, and that sent a clear message to everybody that the army means business, and that helped in, reducing the furiosity of the riots. Worse than the police were the home guards. There were 20 battalions of home guards. All the commandants of the home guards were members of right-wing organizations. So they were blatantly anti-minority. And the police was, I would say, I won't say they were participant, but they were neutral. They didn't participate. What really bothered me was the absence of the police hierarchy. I found that the actual people were the subordinate SOs who were doing the actual work. There were MLAs sitting in most police stations giving directions. So I said, where are the SPs, SSPs, and others? Because other than DGs and DIGs and additional IGs, I didn't find the middle rung, which is the execution, arm of execution of anything. I mean, in the army, you see captains and majors doing all the work. But these were not visible at all. I did recommend to Mr. George Fernandez that you get a police chief from outside the state. And he says, General Shah, you've taken the words of my mouth. And we were expecting a change in the police chief, but nothing happened. Mr. Gill was brought in much later. But it was the partisan attitude of the police. But this is not the case only in Gujarat. It is prevalent right across the country. They've been communalized. I don't blame them. They're living in that area. So they have to deal with these people. They have to deal with the politician. Why should they get into trouble? Of course, they know that the army just comes and does its job and gets out. So it's always a very neutral role which the army plays. What is disturbing is the role of the paramilitary. I'm not saying they were partisan, but the hierarchy of the CRPF and the BSF had absolved themselves of all responsibility. They had divided their troops into companies which were given under charge of the police. So instead of doing anything, they imbibed the police ethos and did nothing. So this is the second line of defense. Whenever they are committed, they should move in with their command and control organization. There should be a DIG, there should be an IG commanding the paramilitary forces. They should not be placed under the control of the police. Because if you do that, they become part of the local police.
Well, sir, we are kind of running out of time. Everything that you're saying is of tremendous importance for this country because, as you said, three commissions were set up. It's shocking if commissions of inquiry don't call the general of the army who's quelling the riots, and this is a commission of inquiry into the riots. So I think that that is something that should really be taken cognizance of. And secondly, that SIT report cleared the political establishment headed by Mr. Modi of any delays in calling in the army. But here's the army officer asserting that there was a delay. Sir, it may have made a lot of difference if you'd spoken up 10 years ago.
I didn't know about anything about these commissions. I did read in the paper and such things. They never asked me. They should have. They didn't read my report. And I didn't know what the SIT had submitted till after I had written the book. And I mentioned the delay. They read out the SIT paragraph, which says that transport and everything was provided on the night of 28th. And I said, that is a blatant lie. I called that report a blatant lie, and I stand by what I said. And then people accused me of lying. And I said, my troops will stand by what I have said. My command will stand by what I have said. Above all, I said, they are the battle histories of the battalions involved, which have recorded it. And I said, the battle histories, the war diaries of the units committed will not lie. But nobody's examined that. My report, I don't know where it lies, is probably gathering dust. But that gave the factual position of what actually happened.
And I'd just like to put on record that General Padmanabhan that General Padmanabhan has stood by every word that General Shah is saying about what really happened in Gujarat with the army that was called in. That he stood by your words as
well. Yes, he did, because I gave him a report. I went personally to his office and I gave it to him. And what he told me, he says he took it to the Prime Minister and said, Prime Minister, you better do something about it, or the country will be torn by this by these riots. And he says he personally gave it to the Prime Minister Vajpayee. And he is always stood by, well, I stand by the army. I said that when you asked me about religion, I said, while in uniform, the uniform was my religion. My religion was my private business between my maker and myself. It didn't interfere in whatever I did. And that's the way it should be.
So, sir, unfortunately, we've run out of time, and I'm going to take some questions from the audience. But while I'm just looking through the questions, will you briefly talk about the two or three really difficult issues that you had to face in Aligarh Muslim University, where, again, now this was from within the community. You were the Sarkari Muslim serving the army. Now you were the Sarkari Muslim trying to make a university that was going conservative, liberal and secular again. So what were the battles you had to fight there? And secondly, the whole issue about madrasas, that, you know, you grew up in a madrasa school. And there definitely is an idea that the madrasas are the kind of nursery for trouble for the Muslim community itself, because it engenders a regressive mentality. What do you feel about that? And I'll quickly look.
Firstly, about madrasas. I started my education in a madrasa, and I'm very proud of it. They've been demonized for no reason at all. The problem is that madrasas are only giving Quranic teaching. How many imams and muezzins can the country absorb? So I've been pressing, and I said so, and there was a fatwa issued against me when I said the madrasas have got to modernize. Quranic teaching, yes, it is an important part, but bread and butter issues should also be taught to the students. And I did go to Deoband and I did go to Bareilly, and I tried to impress upon the rectors of these two institutions, but they were not prepared to listen to me. So I said the top-down approach doesn't work, so we started the bottom-up approach. And in Aligarh Muslim University, we started a course called the Bridge Course. That's the bridge from madrasa to university education. We have, for the last 5 years, run this bridge course, 75 boys, 25 girls. We have given them a dose of English, a dose of computers, and a dose of social sciences. And let me tell you that these students have immense capabilities. If you memorize the Quran, you can memorize anything. That is their capability. And the accusation that they are terrorists producing factories is all myth. It is to demonize the madrasas. Yes, there have been stray incidents. You know, all the people who took part in 9/11 were not madrasa students. They were educated fellows from American universities and others. So we want to modernize the madrasas. The bridge course was the first attempt to do it. These students who have passed out, 500 of them, have got admission into Indian universities through open competitive examinations. Some for, you won't believe, English honor courses. This is their capability. These are going to be the agents of change who will bring about a change in the madrasa education. It's the bottom-up approach, which was very successful. Now about Aligarh Muslim University. I was serving in the Armed Forces Tribunal when a delegation from Aligarh Muslim University came and said, you know, Aligarh Muslim University needs the doors of discipline. General Saab, you give your name to be considered. Now, Aligarh Muslim University, being a minority institution, has its own method of selection. There's no selection committee. You are voted in by the community. So I thought about it. My brother, who's an alumnus of AMU, my father-in-law, and my whole lot of relatives advised me, don't go. They says it's not an easy university to run. But I don't know, I felt that it was a calling. And when I gave my resignation from the Armed Forces Tribunal, I said, it is a calling which I must answer. So I was elected as the Vice Chancellor. I landed up there. And of course, General Shah is an alcoholic.
General Shah is a womanizer. General Shah is corrupt.
General Shah is a womanizer. How it happened is that in Ahmedabad, I had to sack a CO for visiting a Muslim woman, divorced woman. I had to sack him. He was moved overnight. The accusation was that out of jealousy, I moved this colonel out. Because I was in. So the same accusation came back. In fact, they tried to have a CBI inquiry. Of course, it was nonsense. Anyway, we imposed a dose of discipline. The first was disciplining the teachers, telling them to come in proper dress, come shaven in, or come with a beard if you have one, but not unshaven. And proper dress, we disciplined the students' union. I had to sack the president of the students' union, which had never been done. He thought there would be a revolution in the university. There wasn't a whimper. Because we threw him out, and I expelled him. That sent the message across that this fellow means business. And let me tell you something which you are not aware of. Times Higher Education London and US News and World Report graded Aligarh Muslim University as the best university of the country in the academic year 2017-18. That is my final year. This was done by imposing discipline and by encouraging research, path-breaking research in three or four things. We identified what the problems of the country were. Food, our nanotechnologists have made the nanofertilizer, which don't pollute. Water, we've devised a technique of anaerobic digestion, which has been accepted in Project Ganga and Yamuna. Our scientists are working on that, and they will succeed. There's no power requirement. All the stations, 110 stations established by the government, are non-runners because of the power requirement. So because of that, Aligarh Muslim University, to a lot of people who dislike the very name, it's anathema to them. But it is the best university of the country.
So, sir, I'm sorry we've run out of time, but just quickly to share with you that this was probably the biggest battle he had to fight, because he was fighting the university, entrenched interests. He was fighting Smriti Irani, not an easy adversary to have. And he was fighting the community, you know. So, but within all of that, General Shah writes that it's the training in the army that helped him really take on the fight in the university and to come through that alive, you know. So thank you very much for all the battles that you have fought. I wanted to ask you about the controversy around Jinnah's portrait, you know, about the whole attempt to create a secular school for Muslims in every district in the country, definitely starting with UP, again, an initiative that you started. There weren't any questions from the audience, because I think you've given too many riveting stories. I'm sure there are going to be a lot of cocktails.
I just want 2 minutes more.
Okay, sure.
You know, I'm convinced that discrimination is against the less educated. It is not against religion. Otherwise, I would have retired as a major or probably a colonel. I'm convinced on that, and I'm being no hypocrite. And it was because of schooling. Schooling is something which the Muslim community, impoverished, cannot afford to send their children to. So obviously their children face discrimination. We are establishing a chain of secular schools which is going to fulfill this need, crying need, for the Muslim community, and we are going to succeed. Ladies and gentlemen, I have fought many battles, but I've never lost. And in this also, we are going to succeed. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Jain.
Thank you very, very much, General Shah. We look forward to having you in Bangalore, and we'll break for drinks. There'll be a lot of conversation. And thank you very much for all the battles we fought, as we said, for embodying the cultural conversation and living it out as you have. Thank you.
Thank you for this honor.